If you will, turn with me in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5 is where we're going to be today. If you would like to follow along with us and you do not have a Bible, you can grab one of those Bibles that's in the chair rack in front of you. And if you don't know where to find stuff in the Bible, that's okay. We're going to be on page 1023. That's where you can find the verses that we're going to be looking at in 1 John chapter 5. And if you don't own a Bible, you can take that Bible home. You are not stealing it. You just walk right out here with it. We've got plenty of Bibles. We'll restock, but we want to make sure that you have a Bible if you do not have one. We are in our last section of 1 John today. We're going to be looking at it this week, and Lord willing, looking at the second part of it next week, but we are in the home stretch of 1 John, and then after that, we will, God willing, have one sermon after that while we try to wrap our minds around some of the lessons that we have learned as we have been through this passage of Scripture, or this book. But this morning, we're going to be looking at verses 13 to 21 of 1 John chapter 5. And I don't know about you, but when I need information on some kind of upcoming product or some kind of upcoming event, or I want information on some kind of developing news story, I go to the internet and I start Googling it. And when I'm looking for this information about this product or this event or some kind of story, one of the things that you'll often see if you've ever done this is you'll see a phrase, and that phrase either appears in the title of the article or it appears very near the beginning of the article. And that phrase is simply this: here's what we know so far. Something that we're looking up. Here's what we know so far. So I Googled that phrase and found this sampling of results. Will there be a fourth stimulus check? Here's what we know so far. Who does Katie Thurston pick on The Bachelorette season 17? Here's what we know so far. The Ford Maverick appears next week. Here's what we know so far. Now, those examples that I've given you are rather mundane and trivial unless you are desperate for a fourth stimulus check. But there are times when tragedy strikes, either in our own backyard or somewhere else in the world, and we are worried, we are concerned, we are scared, we want answers. And oftentimes we will tune in to the news or something like that, and the news will list several things that we don't yet know about that situation, that thing that has occurred. But then after listing all the things they don't know, they'll say, here's what we do know. Here's what we know so far. When you think about it, in life, you and I are so limited by what we don't know, aren't we? We would like to think that as we grow up and mature and get older, we will learn more and more things, and the whole picture of everything that's going on in the world that we didn't understand as kids is just going to somehow come together. And yet the older you get, it's true, the more you realize how little you actually know. And not only are there things that we don't know, there are all sorts of things that we can't explain. There are all sorts of things that we can't understand. Which is why when we are grappling with all the things that we don't know and we're trying to make sense of a world that often seems senseless, when we are trying to understand a world that seems like it's completely out of control, it can be helpful to stop and take stock of the things that we do know. Because oftentimes when we feel when we're caught in that spiral of not understanding and not being able to make sense of the things that are happening around us, we get lost in that. And we feel like there's nowhere to stand. There's no firm foundation. I can't be certain of anything. But it can be helpful at those times to take stock of what we do know. John's audience that he had originally written this letter to were people just like you and me. Yes, they lived in a culture that we don't understand. They had things that were familiar to them that they understood very clearly that are not familiar to us. They were separated from them by centuries and centuries. But they struggled with the world they lived in. They often had more questions than answers, just like you do. Do you ever question why God has allowed certain things to occur the way they've allowed in your life? Have you ever thought, man, if I was in charge, this would be going differently? Have you ever struggled to reconcile the truths that you know about God with your reality and the things that you are experiencing? Do you struggle with sin and wonder why, after all these years, am I still here? I thought I'd be here, but I'm here. Do you have the hurt of broken relationships that you've experienced in your lives, some of which you don't even understand why? You would love to know why this has happened the way it's happened. As I said a few weeks ago, do you ever feel like you are just hip deep in the mud of the world? We are finite beings, which means that we are incredibly limited, aren't we? There is so much that we don't know. There is so much that we don't understand. There are so many answers, so many things that we would like to ask God, questions that we would like to have answered that we do not have answers for right here and right now. I would love to be able to peel back to the very last page of the book and see how everything ends and how all of these pieces work out so I could understand the secret counsel of God, but I don't know those things. When you, though, are feeling the weight of everything you don't know, when you are feeling the burden of everything that you can't understand, we need to find assurance, we need to find rest, we need to find stability in the things that we do know. And friends, the Bible tells us that there are things that we can and do know. In this final section of the letter we call 1 John, you'll notice that John uses the phrase, "we know," several times. Because in all the uncertainty of life, he wants to give his readers, the scriptures want to give us the assurance that while there are many things that we don't know, there are things that we do know so far. And those things will steady us as we're battered about by the winds of life's circumstances that we cannot understand. So here's the truth that I would like for us to consider together this morning. It's this: in the midst of uncertainty, find security in what you know. In the midst of uncertainty, find security, find assurance in what you know. I see five truths. These verses 13 to 21, five truths, things that you can take to the bank, things that you can know. We're going to look at two of those things this week, and then Lord willing, we'll look at the other three next week. But here's the first truth we know so far. Number one, we know that we have eternal life. We know that we have eternal life. We can see that in verse 13. And if you're there in 1 John chapter 5, let's look at it together. The Bible says this, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. If you've been with us for this series, then you know that this verse has been a guidestone that we have come back to again and again and again. We call this series Paternity Test because God wants you to know who your Father is. God does not want his children swimming around, trying to figure out, wondering if he is truly their father. If you have come to Christ, God wants you to gain an assurance that God is your father. God wants you to have an assurance that he loves you more than you could even imagine how much you are loved. He wants you to have an assurance that you have eternal life waiting for you, that you are going to spend an eternity experiencing the riches of your benevolent Father's kind heart. He does not intend for you to wait to experience that assurance. He wants you to be able to take it to the bank now, which is why John says, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. Of course, that doesn't mean there's something defective about you if you doubt. It doesn't mean that genuine Christians, true Christians, never doubt. We are habitual doubters. What it does, though, is that God does not intend to leave us hanging. John Stott said this several years ago about this text. He said, it is common today to dismiss any claim to assurance of salvation as presumptuous and to affirm that no certainty is possible on this side of death. But certainty and humility do not exclude one another. If God's revealed purpose is not only that we should hear, believe, and live, but also that we should know, presumptuousness lies in doubting his word, not in trusting it. Let me read that last phrase to you again. Presumptuous then lies in doubting his word, not in trusting it. And God wants you to believe what he's told you in his word, that you can be assured that you are forgiven of your sins and that God is your loving Father. This statement of purpose here at the end of 1 John is very similar to the statement of purpose in John's gospel, his biography of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John being the one I'm referring to, the gospel of John. And he says this in the purpose statement of John, in John 20, verses 30 and 31. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that, there's purpose, so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So whereas the purpose statement in John's gospel is meant to lead people to belief in Jesus, the purpose statement in John's letter, 1 John, is to lead people into assurance from Jesus. So in John's gospel, belief in Jesus, John's letter, assurance from Jesus. But did you see as I read those two things, the one thing that both of those purpose statements have in common? The ultimate goal for each one of these things for us is the experience of life. That's the point. This experience of life has a future aspect to it, which is why the Bible speaks of it as eternal life. And I've just, a few moments ago, mentioned the fact that all who belong to Christ, all who have repented of their sins and put their faith in Christ and their trust in Christ, have an eternity awaiting them where God pours out the abundance of the riches of his grace upon us. But there is also a present aspect to the life that Jesus offers his people. In other words, you don't have to wait to experience life. The Bible tells us in the words of Jesus in John chapter 10 and verse 10, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. The abundant life is not reserved for the sweet by and by. It is also meant for the difficult and uncertain here and now. Many times I fear for myself, I suspect for some of us here, that we live as if there was no present aspect to this abundant life in Christ that he talks about. Someday, but not today. There is a story, an old book that some of you may have read when you were kids or seen the movie called The Secret Garden. And The Secret Garden is this story about this girl named Mary who has wealthy parents who are living in India, and they die, and she becomes an orphan. And so through a series of events, she is brought to live with her uncle back in England and live at her uncle's estate. Her uncle is a man who is overcome with grief because his wife has passed away. There's a garden on this estate that she used to love and care for. She passed away in that garden, and in his grief, that garden is walled up, the door is locked, and he has buried the key somewhere on the property so that no one can ever enter that garden again. But Mary finds the key, and she begins going into the secret garden. But that's not the only thing that she finds on the estate, because as she's exploring, she finds out that there is a little boy her age living in this estate, in this house. And this little boy turns out to be her cousin, Colin. And Colin is bound to his room. He has some sort of unspecified spinal problem, and so he is always in bed. If he tries to get up or do anything, his nurses make sure that he stays in bed, and so he never does anything or goes anywhere. And Mary begins visiting Colin, and she begins telling him about the secret garden. And the more she tells him about the secret garden, the more he asks to visit it, until finally she agrees to get him there. So they get a wheelchair of some kind, and she takes him to the secret garden. And through a series of events, Colin stands up. His legs are weak from lack of use, but as it turns out, he does not have this terrible disease that everybody thinks he has. And as he spends time in this garden, he begins to be able to walk and run and play with all of the other kids. Colin could participate in life. He just didn't know it. And not knowing that held him back. And I think we can be kind of like him sometimes. Our own doubts about life, our own lack of understanding, our own uncertainties, our own questions cripple us. We, in the light of all the things we don't know, we forget that there are all kinds of things that we do know, that God has revealed to us with certainty, and that one of those things is that Jesus came so that you and I might have an abundant life, which means it is possible. Without me being able to explain it all, but if you're a saint who has walked with the Lord for any amount of time, you can testify to this truth. It is possible to walk through difficulty. It is possible to walk through trial. It is possible to have questions that you would really like God to answer about why things are the way they are, and yet still experience life. Because you have the life of Christ, a fountain of living water welling up within you, which is a foretaste of the glory coming. God wants to lead us into that abundant life that is ours in Christ. And let me just say this, if you are here with us this morning and you don't know Jesus, the abundant life of Christ can be yours. the good news of the gospel is that even though we are naturally separated from God because of our sin and deserving of his judgment, God sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. God sent his Son to propitiate, 1 John tells us, to appease his own wrath, so that all those who repent of our sins and put our faith in Christ might drink from the fountain of living water that never runs dry. And it may be that God has brought you to our church on this morning to hear that message, so that you will repent of your sins and be saved. That is what we would want for you, to experience the assurance knowing that no matter what happens in life, no matter who leaves you or who forsakes you, you have a heavenly Father who will never let you go. And you can't disappoint your way out of his love. There's a second truth that we can know in this passage, and it's this. Number two, we know that God hears us. We know that God hears us. Look with me at verse 14. The Bible says, "And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests that we have asked of him. If anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask, and God will give him life to those who commit sins that do not lead to death. There is sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray for that. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin that does not lead to death." Okay. What in the world, John, do you mean by that? Here's what I want us to do. First of all, I want us to remember what the headline is. So if you have to do this, you've got to write it down. The headline of all of this, the forest, we're going to zoom in on a couple trees, but the forest is God hears us. That's the thing, and all the stuff that we have to sort through to try to do our best to understand exactly what John means by that, I don't want that very important point to get lost. We'll come back to it. But as we've read these passages, as we've read these verses together, we're probably left with a couple of questions. Number one, what is the sin that leads to death, and why does he tell his readers, why does John tell us he's not asking us to pray about that? So let's start with the first question. What is this sin that leads to death? That's a pretty scary thing to read, right? If there is a sin that is an immediate game over sin that I need to know about, I want to know what that sin is so that I do not commit that sin and not be able to repent of it. There are people who understand that passage this way. What I want to do is just try to simplify lots of discussion about these verses and divide everything up into two basic perspectives of how to view this difficult text. The first perspective is that the sin that leads to death is some kind of specific sin or list of sins. In this view, John has in mind some sort of sin or list of sins for which there is no return. They're game over kinds of sins. So various things have been suggested throughout the years. The seven deadly sins, the Catholic idea of mortal sins. Our Catholic friends have a difference between mortal sins and venial sins. That's been a suggestion. There are some who have suggested that perhaps this is the sin of suicide, because suicide is final in the sense that you can't repent of it once the sin has been committed. But there's a couple problems with this line of thinking which make me think this is not the way to go. The first is that this passage gives us no particular sin or list of sins. And so bringing in a particular sin or list of sins from outside is not the wisest idea. Now, it's true that one of the principles of Bible interpretation is that we interpret the clear, the unclear. I want to give you the opposite of the principle. One of the principles of Bible interpretation is that we interpret the unclear in light of the clear. In other words, we don't want to take the most obscure text in the Bible and build our whole theology out of a very disputed and unclear text. What we want to do is work our way down. We start with the things that we can know for certain, and then we work our way down to the things that are less clear, and we apply the things that we know to the things that are more difficult for us to know. But there is no particular sin or list of sins mentioned here in our text. The second problem I see with this is that the Bible does not talk about, the Bible does not in any place give a sin or a list of sins that is more damning than others. Now, the Bible does talk about sins that there's a sense in which they are more serious than others. For instance, if I throw a can out of my car window onto the road, I've littered. Or I can murder someone. There's a difference in degree to those sins. We all understand that there are differences in consequences. But the Bible does not talk about any sort of sin as being more serious than others. There is no sin or sins that make us unreachable by God's grace. In fact, we see as we read through the Bible on page after page, God's people, God's saints, committing the most horrible, unspeakable sins. And none of those sins are outside of Christ's saving reach. So that leads me to a second perspective, which I believe is closer to the mark. I'm going to give this perspective just the simple heading of what John is talking about here is unbelief. Unbelief. And I like this perspective on the text for a couple of reasons. The first is that it takes into account the immediate context of what's been going on in 1 John. All through the book of 1 John, if you've been with us, we have seen glimpses and then outright explanations that there were people, that these people who had received this letter, there were people who had been part of their church family that had left. And they had left, they had separated themselves from these people because they were denying certain aspects of the person and work of Jesus. And John refers to these people in one place as false prophets. He refers to them as, in another place, as antichrists. He says that they are without the Son of God and they are without life. These are people who are not directly or completely denying Christ altogether, but they are denying certain aspects of both the person and work of Christ. Secondly, second reason why I like this understanding is it harmonizes, I think, nicely with the only other passage in the Bible that I know of with a similar idea as the one that we found here. It may have come to your mind already, but that passage is Mark chapter 3 and verse 29. In that verse, Jesus says, "But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin." Now you might stop and say, well, wait a minute, what's that? That verse is talking about blasphemy of the Spirit. You're talking about unbelief here, rejection of something about Jesus. I'm not sure that I see the connection. But the connection is found in the context of why Jesus says this in the first place. Do you remember why Jesus talks about the blasphemy of the Spirit in the first place? Jesus has been casting out demons, and there are people who have said he's casting out demons by the power of Satan. He himself has a demon. If that isn't a rejection of the person and work of Jesus Christ, I don't know what is. To claim that the works that Jesus does are somehow fueled by the power of Satan himself. And John has already told us that the Spirit, that Jesus has given us the Spirit to testify to his truth, to the truth of who he is and what he has done. And so to reject Jesus in unbelief is to blaspheme the Spirit who testifies to Jesus. And so it's for those reasons that I believe that what John has in mind here is a sin of unbelief, of rejection of Jesus, this general category of unbelief. But there's a second question we might be asking. Why does John tell us he's not talking about praying for a person who has committed that kind of sin, who's in this state of unbelief? Well, I don't think John would say that it is impossible for a person who has rejected Jesus to repent of their rejection of Jesus and turn to him in faith. I don't think we would say that you got one shot, you reject Jesus, you're done. Now, why might we say that's a true statement? Does anybody come to your mind that's pretty well known in the New Testament for their rejection of Jesus that later became a pretty close follower? Paul? Okay, Paul hates Jesus. And he hates Jesus so much that he's going around from city to city trying to kill people who love Jesus. I would say that is a pretty stern rejection of Jesus. And yet Jesus taps him gently on the shoulder, knocking him off his high horse on the road to Damascus. And Paul turns from a person who vehemently rejects and hates Jesus to a person who pours himself out so that Jesus is known. So I don't think John would say that it is absolutely impossible for a person who has rejected Jesus to turn to him in faith. But the Bible does warn of a hardness of heart that can be developed over time, where you are confronted with the truth of Jesus, who he is, what he's done, and again and again and again over time say no, or the equivalent of no, maybe later. Unbelief has a way of warping us, hardening us in our sins. And I've said this before, but I'll say it many times again. One of the most scary things ought to be that God could give you what you want. Because the light, the true light, comes into the world, and the Bible says, men loved the darkness rather than light. And sometimes God says, if you don't want the light, you can have the darkness. John's point here is that the person that he is encouraging his readers to pray for is not the person that fits in that category at this moment. Not that we can never pray for a person who is continually stiff-armed Jesus, but that the person he has in mind is a different kind of person, a brother or sister who is engaging in some kind of sin. For a brother or sister, for somebody who has truly been born of God and truly has God as his or her father, the good news is that there is no sin that leads to death, because those sins have been fully and finally dealt with at the cross. And that's going to start drawing us back then to our main point. The reason that he says, I'm not talking about praying for the people who are persisting in this sin of unbelief is this: a person can't be forgiven of their sins if they reject the only means by which forgiveness comes. There is forgiveness in Christ, abundant forgiveness in Christ for everything that you could ever do, but there is no pardon outside of him. Now, zooming back out, what John is telling us is that one of the prayers that God promises to hear and answer is the prayer for a brother or sister who is engaging in some kind of sin. That's my best attempt to understand what is a difficult portion of Scripture. But now, we zoom out, and I remind you of the headline. Because when we're looking at the individual trees and we're trying to figure out how to sort out difficult sections of Scripture, we can sometimes forget the point. What's the point? God hears you. And why do you need to be reminded of that? Because when life is difficult, when life is uncertain, when God is allowing things that you think he clearly should not be allowing, when God's sovereign providence runs against your desires, when there are broken things in your life that you wish you could maybe not even be fixed, but just have answers for, it's in those times we think that God can't hear. In the midst of all the uncertainty and all of the things that we don't know and can't explain, one of the conclusions that you cannot draw is the fact that God is no longer listening to you. And one of the amazing things about God is our infinite God is giving you all his attention. Every bit of what he has can be directed to every one of us. Is that not an amazing thought? We are fragmented. We speak of plates that are spinning. We speak of things that are of ourselves as being pulled in all kinds of different directions. God experiences none of it. While you're looking for a place to stand, your Father, the Scriptures tell us, is here, and he's ready to hear. And your dad's got deep pockets to meet your needs. What are some needs that we can guarantee God will meet? There's all kinds of things we want. I got a list a mile long of stuff I want. God doesn't owe me those things. But there are needs that God guarantees he will meet. Anyone here ever wonder if God's going to keep listening to you because of your sin? Especially when it's the same sin? Jesus tells us we're supposed to forgive 70 times 7. Are you kidding me? I got trouble with one. One. I got a one strike and you're out policy. Jesus says 70 times 7. Because I'm like that, I project who I am unto God. And I think God is a man like me. But he's not. And you can commit that sin again and again. You fall and get back up. You can come to Jesus confessing your sins, being faithful and just to forgive, knowing that he's faithful and just to forgive. And he doesn't just mean it the first time or the third time or the fifth time or the tenth time. He does not run out of forgiveness. So you better talk to him, because he hears you. You have a problem sometimes loving your brothers and sisters in Christ? They're super annoying, aren't they? God delights in answering a prayer to give us a heart for people we find difficult to love. Do you need help with your desires? Do you sometimes feel like you are just a big, balled up tangle of sinful desires? What the Bible refers to in 1 John is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of living. Ask your Father. He hears. Tell him what you are experiencing and know that he delights in answering. Do you have a heart that condemns you? God's greater than your heart. Talk to him about it. Do you feel like you can't keep his commandments? Talk to your dad about it. The Bible says in 1 John that his commandments are not burdensome. Ask him to give you that kind of heart. The truth of the matter is, we could go on and on listing the things, but God has deep resources to meet the deepest needs of your heart. So rather than fumbling around saying, "It's me again, I'm sorry to bother you, I won't come back tomorrow, I'll get it right next time, I'll get my act together," all of the stupid things that we do, the Bible says, your Father hears, so go. As you are, with all the problems and failures, knowing that he is going to meet you where you are and give you exactly what you need. We'll finish this, Lord willing, next week, but in a world of uncertainty, in a world where we are constantly struggling to get our footing, there are things that we can know. You can know that you have eternal life. And you can be assured that your Father hears. We're going to share the Lord's Supper here as we close our service this morning. There are two things that I want to guide our thinking with as we share in the Lord's Supper together today. When we take the Lord's Supper, we are saying something that is both vertical and horizontal. There's something that we are saying about Christ. There's something we are saying to each other. And I want to give you two truths to consider as you drink this cup and eat this bread. The first is regarding the vertical relationship. When you take the cup and the bread in your hand and put them to your lips, you are saying by faith, "I believe what the Scripture says, that what Christ has done in his sacrificial death and his miraculous resurrection has made me right with God, and I am a possessor of eternal life." You are eating and drinking life. Give thanks for that. I like to remind us from time to time that when we share in the Lord's Supper together, it is not just me and God time. We are supposed to take the Lord's Supper gathered around a table, as it were, though there is not a literal table here for us to gather around. We're doing it together. We're doing it with each other. And there's something I want to remind us of from the passage of Scripture that we need to commit ourselves to. And that is the fact that when we share these things, we are saying that we have fellowship and commitment and covenant and community with each other, which means that, among other things, we are committed to each other's good. which means that when we see our brother or sister in sin, we don't talk about it to somebody else. We don't think, I mean, I would never do that. We don't think to ourselves, how could they? Because we're made of the same stuff. It's very obvious how we could. And so what we do in celebrating these elements together is we commit ourselves to the good, which means when we see each other in sin, we pray for each other, knowing that there is a God in heaven who delights in answering the prayers of his saints who are committed to each other's holiness and growth in Christ. Here are some instructions before we begin. We're going to have somebody that's going to be going down the center aisle in just a moment. They'll be dismissing you by aisle. You'll go out to the outside of the aisles. You'll come up. We've got tables on either side where you can get an individually wrapped package. You're going to return the same way you came on the outside aisles so that we don't knock anything over in the center aisle. Let me say who can participate in the Lord's Supper. The Bible tells us, this is not something that we have come up with, the Bible tells us that this is something that God's people participate in. This is something for people who have been born again, who have put their faith in Christ. And so if you have not been born again, if you have not been put your faith in Christ, we would ask you not to participate, not because we don't like you or wish to exclude you, because there will be other people who do not come up, but because we want you to consider something that is important. And it's what I talked about earlier in the message today. Do you have eternal life? If the answer to that question is no, if you do not know with certainty that you belong to Jesus, then what we would encourage you to take your time doing is repenting of your sin and pouring out your heart in faith to Jesus and saying, Jesus, save me. I have no hope apart from you. He delights in answering those prayers. So, let's go ahead and start now being dismissed by Rose to share in this Lord's Supper together.